A goldfish expert trying to give knowledge and share things about goldfish. And from the crowd, there was a heckler. And in the question session, he was asked, how do you identify a male goldfish from a female goldfish? So naturally, this guy really didn't know. So he said, the male goldfish eats the male worm and the female one eats the female worm. So the questioner, heckler, didn't want to leave and said, okay, how do you identify a male worm from a female worm? And this guy answered, I'm a goldfish expert, not a worm expert. So hope we don't do such things and we'll try our best to answer your queries when you have the questions. So I didn't know that it's going to be this select an audience because a lot of things you may find that I'm just saying what you already know. So I tried to collect some data on what exactly would we call as urban poor and what exactly is happening on the scenario between say urban and rural. And of course, snapshot of urban poor in India and need skill development, training, etc. and Tata Motors approach for skilling the urban poor. So there are of course two structural streams for skill acquisition in urban India. One is formal and the other is informal. And formal side, already we know that it's either higher technical education or vocational education, technical training, apprenticeship training. And then in informal side, it's family occupations, on-the-job training under master craftsmen. No linkage to formal education, of course. And now a third kind of variety is coming under the dynamic leadership of Mr. Chinoy, like you heard so many things, which you can say is informally formal or formally informal. So he's trying to tap even further areas, which is very much required. Because if we really don't focus on our skilling in the country, I think that can become a big bottleneck for the development of India. The way we are developing, and you will see in my slides that later, there's going to be a huge shortage, like Mr. Chinoy also shared in his slide. So continuing with the formal one, okay, we have 1244 polytechnics, 5,114 ITIs, and surprisingly, most of you may think that ITIs are, you know, other form of government or whatever, but actually there are more private ITIs than government ITIs. So that may be news for some of the people. And there are around 20,800 public-private sector establishments under the Apprenticeship Act. This is, of course, 2006 data. So against 12.8 million per annum new entrants to the workforce, the training capacity existing is only 3.1 million. So this again is a big challenge and we need more of Mr. Chinoy's initiatives and his organizations and lot of other people also, Mr. Kheirs and his organization, because actually we are very short on this. And skilling has not generally been looked up in India. It's been looked down upon and that is why we face a problem. Like if you see the last point in my slide, this only about 2% of existing workforce has skill training against 96% in Korea, 75% in Germany, 80% in Japan and 68% in United Kingdom. And that is why we have this paradox also. Like I was the HR head, say, in Volkswagen, General Motors. So a lot of times it was a difficult thing for them to understand. They said, why do you say that it's difficult even to get white collar and all? So many engineers you produce, so many this you produce, accountants you produce. But in the past, India jobs were less. People aspiring for jobs were more. So most of the jobs we actually overqualified. Like where a simple BCom would have worked, we said I need a CA only. So that problem we are facing and the skilled jobs were looked down upon. Like any big corporate of the developed world, if you are sitting in their boardroom or whatever and you say, okay, how many have come through the skilling route? Maybe you will find 40 to 50% of the people have come through that route. And in India, it will be tending towards zero. So that is where we need to catch up and make people realize that everyone need not go for higher education. After a certain education, one can go in the skilling side and later once you're working, again, you can pick up the higher educations also as you grow. So snapshot of urban poor in India. Now this is a very important thing. Whenever we talk, say in India, we say like majority of our population is in the rural area and things like that. I found this topic that the foundation had taken up very interesting because in reality, if you see globally the trend, 2008 was the watershed year. Actually, worldwide, larger percentage of population is urban now rather than rural. And naturally, Mumbai, of course, all of us are very much aware of the problems the slum dwellers face and the slums that have come and things like that. So yes, there is a crying need to focus on the urban poor also. So after 2008, you are seeing that consistently the urban population is increasing compared to the rural population. And this is another depiction that actually from 2020 onwards, actually the increase in the rural population will be the decreasing number rather than increasing. So as the global economy as such keeps on developing more and more, then you will find more and more people are there in the urban centers. Though the beauty is, if you go by some McKinsey reports and all that, there's really speaking no clear-cut definition on urban. There are different definitions. Some people define it as per capita income, some define it as the population of the area, and so on and so forth. So that again is another challenge. Now urban poor, if you see, percentage of urban population 2001 was 28%. In 99, 2011, it's 25%. Then decadal urban population growth is 40%. So this is how it keeps on increasing. And there is, of course, a need to address that issue also. So this is a snapshot of need for skill development. Like, it is estimated that the annual requirement of for trained manpower is going to exceed 50 million by 2022. It's, of course, the projected figures by NCEUS. And skilling opportunities available in manufacturing and service industries itself for the urban poor through 5,500 government ITIs, NGOs, and skill companies. The need for corporate push support to tap these resources and ensure that the gap is covered. Now I come straight to the Tata Motors approach in skilling the urban poor. There may be some overlaps, what you may call as rural also. So basically, we have these apprentice programs. We have training in partnership with NGOs, government, skilling companies, training of key communities. And one of the real big projects we have taken, because we said CS, CSR should not be only so-called philanthropy. In fact, we take objection if someone says CSR is philanthropy. So it should be embedded in business. And as you have seen in Mr. Chinoy's slides, our slide in auto industry, there's supposed going to be a huge, huge shortage of skilled people, and especially drivers. Even right now, when we talk to our big fleet operators, they say 5 to 10% of their trucks are idle because of shortage of drivers. So the problem is going to keep on increasing. So we have taken this driving training institutes with state government, that's why. Along with that, we have this partnership with ITIs to improve the quality of technical education, partnership with NGOs, and then training women as part of women empowerment and formation and sustenance of cooperatives for economic empowerment. And in the driver thing, I will share more in detail when we go a little ahead. This driver training, if you see, Indian roads are the most fatal in the world, only second to South Africa. And that also soon we will overtake them, because we have set up a small CKD operation in South Africa, so I was involved in setting that up also. So I came across that the roads there are excellent. So that's why these people go full speed and full bang. So when our roads also improve, so the chances are that we will overtake them also. And we have per 1,000 vehicles, the road fatalities are 120,000 deaths every year. So there is again a very, very strong need to train people into not only simple driving skills, but defensive driving. And along with that, to cover the shortage of drivers that is facing the industry, because whatever improvements we may make in the railroads, finally, at least the secondary, the last point transportation has to be through road. And as the country develops, we may be having one of the biggest rail networks in the world. But still, that is not sufficient to control, to be able to cover this huge country that we have. So that is why this need is there. So this is a snapshot of the training center. This is Mr. Telang, our MD, and Mr. Badal, of course, in Punjab, the Punjab Chief Minister. So in along with Punjab government, we set up this driver training institute. And accidents, of course, you can see that 78% of the accidents, the cause attributed is to the drivers. Maybe while the authorities are attributing the causes, they may be a little bit tough on the driver. Even if you reduce that by 10%, still it's a large percent. It's 68%. So Tata Motors has an aggressive plan, that's why, to train 3.4 million drivers in next 10 years. And while doing that, we are planning to keep on increasing the centers so that from the 11th year onward, every year we train $1 million drivers fresh. So that's a big vision we have. And for doing that, we realize that these kind of training centers will not be sufficient, because this kind of training center costs minimum around 16 crore rupees. So okay, Punjab government funded in a big way, but all the governments are not able to do that. Though we are in touch with 6-7 other governments who are agreeable to set that, and the output is not that very high. Like from this kind of center, you have in a year around 190 students passing out, and the need is huge. So we worked out on a different model along with this to support this kind of initiatives, that we will have low cost, high volume models also for the driving skills. And the first pilot project we have already inaugurated in Jabalpur in partnership with one of our dealers, Commercial Motors. And like Mr. Chinoy mentioned, we are working with BeAble. So they are our skilling partner. So in addition, the company has also inaugurated, of course, this driver skilling at Punjab. So the challenges that one faces when we were trying to work out on this low cost, high volume model, like of course, in Mr. Chinoy's slide also, you saw that skills side, it's not a very aspirational field. Along with that, if you see the driver field, a lot of other things are there: difficult working conditions, poor remuneration, high risk situations, stigma attached to the driving profession, the lack of training facilities, because the capital cost investment is comparatively on the higher side. Like if you want to train someone for refrigeration skills or mobile repairing and things like that, it's much cheaper than teaching someone driving, especially heavy commercial vehicles, because a truck is a must to have, and the minimum you have to spend is 10 lakhs per center on a truck itself for the heavy commercial vehicle. Without that, they won't be eligible to get the license if they have not had practical skill. Then the regulatory framework also comes in the way a lot of times. And of course, we all know our licensing procedures. So we are trying to focus on all the sides to make this. And we have developed a holistic program for the driver training. One is, of course, that yes, it should be defensive driving skills along with the driving skills, then vehicle maintenance skills and life skill training. Now, this also is very important because we teach them stress management through yoga, because we hear so many cases of road rage, and a driver in general has to stay most of the time on the road. And then we give them also soft skills for handling passengers or traffic police, etc. in this module. We want them all certified on the first aid. And along with that, we teach them some entrepreneurship and financial literacy. Because a lot of people, we are in these centers that we are opening, we will have both LCV and HCV. So a lot of people may be, you know, self-employed owner operators and things like that. So we want them to get that knowledge also. And the whole driving content, keeping the South African experience in mind, we worked out the whole module with Hubert Ebner, which is an Austrian company, because they are already aware of the kind of impact the accidents can have when things, roads are good and vehicles move at a high speed. So we want the drivers we train to be able to cope with the changing situation also as the country develops further. So the highlights of this model are, of course, like I mentioned, that through inputs from reputed professionals, includes aspects like stress management, etc. The course duration is only 45 days, whereas the big training center like one in Punjab and with other governments will open, that takes nearly a year for the person to pass out. So this is much easier for the people to join. Then it's part-time course. It's a co-branded training institutes, like at Ujjain, BeAble is opening an institute with us, which it will be managing the hardware side also. That means buying the truck, having the center where the students come. Whereas in the Jabalpur model, the hardware is provided by the dealer. We have provided the software, the course content, the quality assurance, and the auditing we will do, and things like that. Train the trainer, we will take the first hit, in the sense Tata Motors contributes, and of course the cut sections and all for the training center. And the BeAble people have their own faculty then, and they run the center. But in Ujjain, they will own the center also and run it also. So like this, we have tied up with various skilling agencies, including Evron also. And with them also, we have tied with them. We will be opening further centers, etc. And training centers to be also used for providing refresher training courses. In fact, we were pleasantly surprised, like in Jabalpur, the RTO we found was very, very professional. So he's saying, you guys say yes, and I will make it mandatory that all those who come for renewal of their license, they have to go through this institute, at least the heavy truck drivers, and have a 3-day or a 4-day program. But the center, we just started the pilot, so we said, just hang on for some time, and definitely we would like to do that kind of thing also. Because a lot of people have been trained, they may be driving a vehicle for umpteen number of years, but maybe they really don't know all the defensive driving techniques and how to take better care of their vehicle, etc. Then we have this mechanic motor vehicle training. And I think to save time so that we can have more time for question answer, I won't read all the points. But broadly what we have done is, like here we also want to focus on our affirmative action side also. Like you may be surprised to know that just 50 kilometers away from Thane, there's a really, really backward area called Sakwar. So there we are working with the Ramakrishna Mission, and it's a mostly tribal area, the hinterland for that mission. And there we have the tribal boys coming and staying in the hostel, and there they get this motor mechanic training, etc. And seeing the success of that model, even at Coimbatore, we have opened this same thing. And of course, we have MMB training at Bhiwandi, like with Mr. Kher's organization, we are working on that. And at Chakan, and then in Tamil Nadu with Don Bosco, we have tied up. And MMB Panvel again is with BeAble, and Dehradun already they are operational. So again, here there are a lot of success stories, like a couple of boys after learning the mechanic skills have even migrated to the Gulf, and they make good money, and they're very good advertisement for others to come forward whenever they come back to India. And most of them, when they open their centers, they want to say Tata Motors specialist, or they name their garage itself on Tata Motors and things like that. So that is, that really gives you pleasure that, okay, you have made a difference in someone's life. And this, I think, we can take in a very big way. So we are trying to work out that how we can upscale these kind of models in a really big way. Then 85% of these people who pass out are, of course, very gainfully employed. 15%, it's not that they don't get jobs, but some prefer to go back to their village only and stay. That is the problem. So we are trying to circumvent that also. Like at Sakwar, we are in, again, consultations with the mission that would you be able to spare some area for the trucks to be maintained there itself? Then maybe we can talk to our big fleet operators. They can deploy the drivers from that area then. And the driver goes home after his trip, and the truck gets the normal oil change and all that maintenance done. So it's a win-win situation. Two people get employment from the mission. That is one mechanic and one driver. At least one driver. There are generally two drivers on long-distance trucks. And at the same time, for the fleet operator also, like, he's doing social service along with, you know, having better drivers. Because all our fleet operators say that any person you're giving from Ramakrishna Mission and the dealers, they are very, very keen to take, because these boys are brought up with big discipline also. So that is a USP of these missions. Then with ITIs, we have tied up with 21 ITIs so far. And we contribute in various ways in the management of the ITI, in helping them develop the course content so that it is relevant to the industry. Otherwise, experience of MNCs and all that is very different. Like when they hear ITIs and all are there, they look forward to people being well-trained. But someone who's come with a fitter trade, finally you find that that person hardly even knows what is file, what different kinds of files and things like that. So it is that low, some of the ITIs, the course content and the teaching. So there we try to help, and then guest lectures by employees, etc. And around 5,000 students are benefiting through these tie-ups as of now. In apprentice training, again, I'm just taking a shining case of our Pune plant. All the plants are doing similar kind of work. So more than 9,000 people have been trained. It's of course a very old center. 38 times it's won the regional best establishment, 9 times the national best establishment by Government of India. And various times, like, it has been rated very highly. And in fact, the older people in industry would support this. Actually, our full-time apprentice training is rated so high that a lot of companies to pick them for supervisory levels and things like that. So that is again the proof of the pudding in eating. So we have again customized trainings for urban youth. We have this Shab Tarang, a BPO training, where we have set up a center with Tata Business Support Services, and we are training the youth on computer literacy and all get good placement immediately. Then this we are very proud of, that we could change the life itself of some rag pickers in Pune. And we train them how to drive and carry an ace. And in this, you will be happy to note that 34 were women drivers also. 34 women also took the training. Special carts also for their disposal were made, and all of them have been employed by PCMC. And they really feel now proud of their vocation, because all said and done, no vocation is low or high or whatever. Because if that person also doesn't do his or her job, then again the society may come to a halt over a period of time. So this initiative we have taken in Pune. Then this is again a shining case example, that a cooperative society that was just set up long, long ago, just to keep the spouses of our workmen busy in Pune. Now we have transformed in such a way that they have four lines of business, which includes also electronics and manufacturing cable harnessing. So it's not just a masala and tailoring grainy. And they have a turnover of their own of 6 crores per year. So this again is a very successful case, and we are working on replicating that in wherever our other plants also are located and different areas. So that's all I have to share in the presentation. So thank you very much, and towards a skilled and prosperous nation.